Developing Our Math Minds is a series of conversations and resources about math that is intended to be a journey of growth for families over several weeks. Each week, Minds lead mathematician and product director Brandon Smith and content development manager Nina Wu will be talking about the adjustments families are making to learning at home and the opportunities this situation provides for changing our relationship with math.
How was your weekend?
It was good, you know, lots of cooking projects. It was rainy, so I stayed inside a bunch, enjoying time with loved ones. How about you?
It was mostly, I felt like I was at home a lot. We did try and get out and walk a little bit, but it was definitely had those, they come and go for me, but I had a moment of, you know, feeling really stir crazy, just like, even if you can get out, you're not really, you don't feel the same as getting out as much as you used to and you're walking around.
For sure.
So it was good, but definitely having to just deal with that cabin fever and feeling stuck at home a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, what a time we're in. And I mean, it's hard to tell the difference sometimes between weekends and weekdays. But I think, yeah, it's unbelievable how this is just like affecting everyone in all the ways, in a lot of unexpected ways, I think, too. And everyone's being asked to play a bunch of different roles and, you know, fill in new capacities. And I don't think anyone's been at home for this long in a really long time, like ever. This is so unprecedented.
It's really bizarre. And we've got, you know, I don't feel like anyone's getting through this easily.
No.
There's obviously really, really tough situations. But even if you are gainfully employed and you are fortunate to be able to keep working from home, I mean, you could be a single parent or maybe both parents if there's two adults. Mm-hmm. But you're now having to manage trying to work and just the cabin fever, managing yourself and all of it. And then you've probably just found out that the 2 or 3 weeks that you thought you were going to be homeschooling,
right?
Those weeks have now become months.
For sure.
I mean, are we even going back to school? And, you know, if not, how do you then transition? It's a really weird transition time now being a couple weeks into the quarantine.
It is. And I think, you know, it's probably hitting a lot of people and like really like, people are starting to internalize like, oh, this is a role I'm going to have to embrace. And, you know, and so I think our conversation today will, you know, try to help families and parents and guardians and just everyone with students at home learn how to navigate this new role that you're learning to occupy. It's another full-time job for you and it's unpaid labor, but I think, you know, with the right framing, it can be really fruitful and rewarding, and it doesn't have to be, you know, a monumental challenge. Like, there are resources.
I think for a lot of times it can feel a little frustrating because you're worried that your kid might be falling behind, and maybe your school is throwing too much at you, or you feel like it's not doing enough. But I think one of the most important things is we all need to be very forgiving of one another, gentle and kind, because a school district was not set up to be able to do this. Mm-mm. And they're trying to figure out internet and devices and what learning solutions are going to be available
for their diverse
community. Lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they're managing thousands of kids at some of these schools over a really wide geographic range, mm-hmm. potentially. It's not just the kids in your neighborhood. It's all the kids in your district. And trying to come up with...
Mm-hmm. They have totally different family situations and, you know, needs and resources available or not available to them and different priorities. And I think, yeah, like teachers are... And districts are... being asked to do a lot of this new thinking on their feet and being accommodating in that way. And figuring out the right balance of like how much work to assign and how much, you know, instruction they can do. And I think what you're saying is totally right with like being really forgiving during this time and compassionate. And I think if anything, what this time is teaching us, it's like reaching back to our humanity and how do we interface with one another with kindness and understanding.
There's a lot of progress made in the neuroscience realm on this, that new experiences, especially if you've never had one like it before, gets encoded into your memory largely through the strength of the emotional component.
Oh yeah.
So the way that stress is a very strong emotion, and that's going to encode memories a certain way. Kindness as well, where you feel connected to one another, where you feel that sense of the beauty of humanity, how we come together. Those are also going to be components that code in. But it's also really fascinating that later, when people recall experiences that they've been through, it's almost always recalled through a sense of self-awareness, self-identity. Those moments where you recall a situation, not just from the emotion that encoded it, but as you remember back on it, how you felt about your own identity and self-worth. The fact that the brain does this is incredible, but it also stresses even more that whatever we're working with, because now parents are having to do English and science and math and everything, that it's those emotional states that we're in and the emotional state that our children are in are going to help encode how we remember this experience.
I mean, yeah, this will definitely be a memorable time and go down in the history books. I don't think anyone's going to forget this time. And I think, yeah, I think this is going to be really meaningful and impactful generationally. I'm really curious to see how this plays out in the future. But aside from thinking, you know, far thinking like that.
There's a lot, yeah.
Yeah.
So let's get pragmatic.
Yes.
A little practical so like, for
right now.
Our parents.
I appreciate what you're saying about the neuroscience and like the underlying things that are happening in our brains. And I think this has a lot to speak to, like with the learning that's happening. If you want to speak more to that.
Yeah, so one is just, I think the experience overall is going to encode into our memories largely from the particularly strong emotional experiences that we have. So just as people, as adults, as parents, as role models, how we act in this time, just in general matters, but also specifically from learning, regardless of the subject you're in, it's very well documented that those stressors end up preoccupying your mind and they block learning from happening. So if you're like in math or whatever, if you're just looking at a worksheet and you've seen them before, but just all the components and all of your experiences with it before, you recall, every time you look at that, you recall all those past experiences. And if there's a sense of self-identity through that, you're gonna, you know, greatly drop it. So
I see.
I think stress in general is really important.
Okay. And now I think you're making a different point. I hear you starting to go into a different point where like this makes me think about, you know, a lot of parents and families who might have a history with math anxiety and maybe you didn't have the best experience with math as a student yourself. And so it might be bringing up a lot when your students are now coming home to you with like all this math that you haven't visited in a while and it might even sound new to you. Like it's going to cause you stress and, you know, how you react to that you gets passed down to your child. And so I think, you know, we have like, there are ways to address this.
Yes. And Joe Bowler's done a lot of the research on this about parent engagement. And as I was reading through it, something really powerful hit. And that was, as a parent, it doesn't impact your child that much whether you know math really, really well or not. But the anxiety that you display while you're interacting with them is what matters the most. Parents don't have to know everything. It's how we act when we know it and how we act when we don't. You might not be able to help your child as well as you feel like you want to. You might have that. You might feel like you're not as confident with mathematics at this point, perhaps as you were as a kid. But it doesn't matter how well you are at helping. Like, it's better to be wrong,
right,
and approach that with a positive attitude than it is to always have to feel like you're right. And I think that's a very hopeful message, because it's not just math. We're saying math because we work, you know, we work as for a math nonprofit, but every single subject, the same thing is going to play itself out. So
yeah,
I say just dive in. It's okay to be wrong and it's okay to mess up. The moments that you're right, you're modeling what that should look and feel like for your kids. And the moments you're not right, the same thing is
you're
going
also
to happen.
Modeling, so I think, for your students. Yeah.
You're modeling it still, yeah.
And I think to add to that, it makes me think, or it's a good reminder that learning itself is a verb, it's an act. And so it's like the journey to knowledge attainment or whatever. So I think it's important to remember, if you're working with students as a family member, like as a parent, like you don't have to be the holder of knowledge, this authority figure of all knowing. I think if anything, you're a guide for your student to see what it looks like to learn, like the act of learning.
Yeah. Like model the journey.
Yeah. And I think, you know, that's what students are picking up from you is like, how do you handle struggle? Do you get frustrated? Do you take it on with a good attitude as an opportunity to learn and grow? And I mean, and that's something I think we all are constantly learning and on a journey on is like, how do we handle struggle? I mean, for sure, I get, you know, I can get frustrated and upset, but then that's a moment for me as an adult to remind myself like, oh, this is an opportunity to learn something and grow and improve on the next time. And I think, you know, you can be a team with your student in that way.
Learning, at least I don't know of any cases, and the research suggests that learning gets sticky. It lasts. It's applicable. It becomes transferable only through those moments of productive struggle. So this idea of learning something easy, sometimes it doesn't last as much. And so I think it's just important to embrace that struggle. And I think personally, I think that's one of the biggest things that parents can do is model that journey of learning. And the cool side there is, that means we can also leverage this opportunity, not just to do the normal academic stuff.
Yeah.
We could learn something, learn anything, embark on some sort of new journey as a family. I mean, maybe you're wanting to learn how to floss or not your teeth, you know, your body or whatever. And you struggle and you mess up and you guys do that together. You're going to build a family bond.
Yeah.
And you're also modeling learning.